My paper, which I prepared for today, has been titled as Thinking About Community and Its Most Inherent and Intrinsic Form. And I have to admit this paper never completely ended. I apologize for it, but let's see how good I can improvise it. And this very form of community, which I insist is least mediated, even though it directs the very core of community in its original form. I think it's a quite challenging project to present today. But before I invite goes to the what I prepared, I want to thanks to Bach for everything. I have been in Utrecht for 4 months. And I think first 2 months was like more or less research period, and the last 2 months has been very heavily active production period. I think without the support of the everyone of Bach, I probably just flipped out, didn't achieve anything because of my temperament or disorganization as well as instability. I really thanks for this. And this paper and the interest in community in general is of course based on my own activity as an artist, and I do feel certain necessity to rebuild my motivation first, because I think everyone and anyone is really free from this ethical positioning that I have to kind of prevent myself not misleaded or misunderstood as well as abused. I think, of course, my interest in studying and researching is stemmed from my own kind of questioning and doubtful moments towards my own practices, and it was partly expressed in the short interview with Bina Choi in the newsletter, that I was wondered about myself why I'm so afraid of using the direct references around me, which I definitely and passionately interested in, such as like social event and political and social movements, how I could maintain the almost ignorant distance to the specific changes and movements around me. And it means, like, as you have noticed in the exhibition, I'm quite not using so much the given structure from directly from the reality. And this gave me a necessity to look on other people's art practices around me in recent years. I think from now on I can read a little bit. And also I think I would like to offer you to interrupt me if there is any question. I think that's fine to open up a little bit more than before, as well as three of you next to me. Since the 1990s, we have observed the development of art in a great deal in the context of social research in its various engaged form, with its openness as well as its determination. this development, as well as the social critical practices from 60s and 70s, granted much, and I'm personally in debt to those kind of practice, and it was a kind of ground to develop myself as an artist, and it affected, and I have to admit that those practices affected me much to build up my own position. If I want to look at closely at those tendencies, in 90s art devoted itself much to the involvement with its audience as well as with the society as an extended field of art, through the direct and indirect invitation to its audience in the production of art, as well as the art show, like art production of art as a creative process, and art show as a, of course, also creative, but the more active and offensive mediation of institution to the art production. Why this phenomenon represents the death of order, author or birth of leader dichotomy, in 60s and 70s practices are merely self-containing art practice in which the relation with its audience is still traditional and relies mostly on optical contemplation rather than direct and immediate interactivity. I mean, that's very general and rough assumption. And I think that the further analysis on the art praxis could be partly very vague or even too rough. I apologize for it, but I could not really include all the fineness of the practices, and I have to admit that's my limit. Still, both of tendencies deals with the border of boundary of art and differentiated from an expression of inner world of singular creativity. In the very much discussed and scandalized the text of Claire Bishop's text called Antagonism and Relational Aesthetic, she claims kind of distinction between the two different distinction. Make a distinction of two different kind of practice in recent year. One is by Nicola Brio advocated practices, and the other one is more like she claims that it's more antagonistically laid works represented by the artists such as Thomas Hirschhorn and Santiago Sierra. And in the latter one, we of course see more specific messages than the abstract idea of openness and engagement of in the former practices. And by Claire Bishop claimed the antagonistic practices does not really give the comforting sense of relationship. They more interested in emphasis on the tension around the uneasy circumstance in the political and social domain in the world. I mean, as you see, it's kind of very rough categorizations, but I kind of need those kind of introduction to reflect my own. Reflecting my own practice retrospectively, my formalistic approach of art reception is rather closer to the 60s and 70s practices than no much space for an interaction or the idea of art in use is offered. And again, my narrative resembles the scenario strategies observed much in the work by Liam Gillis. And especially the non-issue addressing rhetoric of Gillick has been incredibly interesting to me to observe. But then again, I have my difficulty to respond much the maybe it's an exaggerated assumption, but this optimistic openness toward the microtopia. And I kind of questioning how to avoid the another disguised form of liberal methodology of negotiation and compromise. And especially I feel even somewhat disturbed by the strategy of art, in which art is operating and establishing the open platform towards the public. And this kind of includes the oppositional position towards the contemplative author's voice. And in this point, I cannot help admitting my helplessness not to able to activate the art practice through the providing to perform completely open to the public, because I do not share the necessity of such a general effort of social openness. And I think this general means quite much in my case, because I think there is for me the distinction between general and universal. Like general is a more sociological term, than universal could be rather philosophical categorization. And despite of all these distinctive differences and distances to the relational art, then again I kind of hesitate with the positions like Hirschen and Sierra, because the directiveness and domination of the artist as the subjective who dominates the bird view towards the society by oneself, like by himself. And without much of introspection of self, and the most of works of doesn't really provide a realistic and does provide like too realistic and therefore could be too overwhelming image of reality. And there is missing certain like gentle distance to create a reliable dynamics and invitation of the others as autonomous as the artist or the author. Even though I partially sympathize much with the antagonistic position as well as the relational art practices, I strongly missing the feministic approach of putting oneself in the position of otherness. But I want to add explanation that for me, I mean, we will come back the notion of otherness again, but the otherness, I don't mean this exclusion-inclusion dichotomy or majority-minority discourses as we gone through in 90s, because let's deal with that later. Seemingly overexposed, dominating and directing position of an artist, those kind of practice does not invite the public as an engaged being as much as the author. And there is a lack of space for the concern about the relationship between expressing voice and the other. No interruption yet? I don't understand you as little as you probably have understood me. Instead of reading, maybe I could just free talking. Maybe we just go through very quickly this my own analyze on the recent art practices, because this is only expressed to relate my own position, and it's not the content of what I'm going to say so much.
I have another little interruption.
Yes.
I was thinking, when you mentioned Santiago Sierras or
Hirschhorn?
Yes, Hirschhorn. It's also got to do with the spectacularity, mm-hmm. No? That maybe you feel that distance. You know what I mean? The impossibility of the engagement maybe also has to do somehow with the rhetorics, not only with the antagonists. Just that. Of those chosen ones, and I think that
I just borrowed the term antagonistic from Claire Bishop just to name them, and I have to admit I'm also not so agreed with her naming of those artists as antagonistic positions, because for me they are more directing position, like artists as a director, mm-hmm. than really bring the antagonistic position through their work so much. Just is to name them somehow. You look so skeptical.
No, I wondered about the woman in the back's comment about the difference between you and you were speaking and reading the text, and maybe if there was some part of the text to focus on. Or if you want to read the whole thing, because it also seems maybe there's enough to open it up.
Mm-hmm. Just yeah, okay. I think that
it's your show.
This is like more or less like the sum up of my view on the practices around me. Just this reflection gives me some space to see like what is my sympathy toward the other practice, and what is the more doubtful part that I want to put more question on it. From this, I was trying to thinking about like these art practices just showing to me, showing to me that the possibility that art could still relate to the broader public field, but at the same time they gave me the question of then how we concretely and specifically position the author and the audience and the relationship in between, and that's the question I want to bring up. And I want to start with the anecdote rejected from an email from a friend of mine who quotes a provocative and ironical question by Spivak saying how many votes for the unconscious? Like how many, putting this question, the Spivak is saying that, you know, somehow the unconsciousness is not the object we are going to discuss about. She suggests that, okay, that's my boundary of research, and I kind of agree with her, not like literally on her opinion on the unconsciousness, but literally the importance of the setting the boundary of who we are talking to and who we are responding to, as well as addressing to. And to talk about the community is somehow, I suggest you to come down with me to the very basic idea of how the one is related with the other, and what is really the we can have a closer look on how they are really related with each other. And because the term community contains the com, in Latin, C-E-U-M, which could be translated in English approximately like the width. Like, so it, the term community implies the with somebody. You know, there is like multiple people who gather together. And mostly in our time, the community is understood as a group of people who shared something. So there are something in common between people. There are sharedness and commonness between these multiple subjectives. And now I'm again quoting how Bhattai, diagnose our word, and he is saying that our word rewards only self-interest and the obligation to work. So, like, this is the society that we are allowed to work. There will be nobody who has objection to it, and this work is quite much dedicated to maintenance of the individuals. I kind of make it's very personal distinction between the individuals and the singular being. I have to introduce the term of singularity compared to the individual, which is more close or connected with the society that each one of society we would call the individual, but the singular being is really touching the very core of each being in the world. And as well as that, single political initiative is more closer to the political context. So there are for me many layers of naming the single element, like we as a single element. And usually we just kind of wrap everything together, like individual stands for the each being, but I think before we go into the political or social level of each one, maybe we should come down to the singular being and what, how they look like and how they stand next to the other. And understand this, I had to quite much study the for me unfamiliar philosophical text as well as art critical text, which was quite a challenging thing to me. Then the Blanchot is describing the singular being who is ultimately confronted by the death, and like that's kind of the everybody kind of shares and cannot deny as a destiny as well as existence. And compared to Heidegger, who insists that death is the very proof of we existing as a singular being, that's my own experience, my own death is my own experience which create my responsibility towards my existence. And Blanchot kind of rely on that definition of death as a core idea of proving our existence. But then again, he alters something that we experience, we cannot the impossibility of the own death. Like, I cannot experience my death by myself, I only can experience somebody else's death. That proves the direct connection between one and the other. So it's not that, like, if we're talking about the community, it seems like there's somebody taking a position to address to the other, but concerning the idea of Blanchot, it's preconditionally thing that is already there, that we are relying on other the other people. It is so it's kind of pre-voluntary relationship what we share with others. I think why I'm talking about this is like the well-ordered the practice which was done by the Nina. I think if we look all this practice based on the idea of how pre-voluntarily, like unconditionally set up the relationship between one and the other, then we could observe those practice quite differently than as we usually would do, because it's not an it's not given as an option so much. It is already there.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
What sure. Made you so you're interested in the individual and the being in this world? But what made you go and the Western European so what made you look into this direction of like the first question you mentioned right now?
You don't know me. I think that's probably much more natural than you expected that I reached at the plunger, because I don't know that I think somehow I don't know that it was very natural if you have the discipline of the research, that you are handed from one book, which I got it like by chance, to the next one. There is actually no, it's a kind of encountering with people.
It's a community of readers.
There's something like that, and I don't think that I could reach like completely different corner of thing, but of course it reveals my limited probably accessibility to many undiscovered things. But I have to say that it's more or less just happened to be so.
Well, they seem to be present in like theory of art.
But then again, I have to admit that Blanchot has been incredibly interesting to me in the sense that he was a writer, like writing a novel, as well as a devoted like literature critic and journalist. And like some of his writings doesn't respond to the existing categorization of literature or journalism, because it's quite in between, and his as well as his opinion, like he doesn't really make a distinction, the clear distinction between literature critique and his philosophical opinions or view. So it has been incredibly interesting, even though it was more or less accidentally happened. And before I reached the Blanchot, course, I knew the book title by Changlok Nangsi, which was also mentioned in Nina's text, and I didn't know before that Nangsi's text is so much closely connected with the Blanchot's text, and there is kind of dialogues going on between these two philosophers about the notion of community as a political form. And the political form, then again, not really so much apart from the politicalness of being as a basic idea again.
The distance from real being happens with the picture as much as with the name.
I think so. But that's more my assumption. It's not the presumptuous idea. Okay.
Well, I just thought when you just said Jeremiah, you felt like the other way around. Like, it, because of the setup here, for example, to name him as Jeremiah as opposed to the moderator or whoever.
Yeah, like social being, that's the representative.
To me, it didn't distance it. It sort of brought it closer. Do you see what I mean? Like, not necessarily language is violent or imposed. It happens a lot, but there's a moment where we sort of agree to forget that it's that it does that, right? And the fact that we agree to forget that language doesn't necessarily mean the thing. It's also it also shows how much we need to talk to each other. Therefore, language is not only a lie.
Yeah, I think through the great deal of the linguistic studies, we kind of aware of this basic, the pattern of how language works well. But the what Blanchot make a distinction to the everyday language is that the naming of poet, like how the literature does, is different than the everyday language. Like if one poet is writing a cat, then you know it doesn't. It's neither a representative of a cat, but also the abstract idea of the cat. That's like very specific. The act of naming of the cat. And that's where that's the moment the Blanchot sees the role of literature, which cannot be replaced by the everyday language, and as well as the existence of poet, and that's kind of how I relate it to his thinking from my point of view is also creating the tool that operating the existing tool.
Sorry, can you explain a little bit how you relate all this reading with your work? How you see it? Or maybe later.
Yes, of course.
Do you want to finish the prepared text, or should we open it up?
I think I have a small amount of what I want to finish until I respond to the relationship of those thoughts with my own practice. The last part is talking about, like, I was talking about quite much the mechanism between the one and the other, and now I'm moving to the multiple gathering, which we named as a community. And we were, while we were preparing this talk, we realized how slippery and elastic the idea of community is. I mean, it could relate the geographically close located group of people, as well as group of people who share the same interest. And you know, there are so many different dimensions and sort of community. I mean, it's very confusing and disturbing. At the same time, it could be exactly interesting, because there is a kind of space that we can penetrate to include for developed further idea. But what, as I mentioned at the beginning, what we cannot deny it is the community suggesting there is the multiple being, and they share something together, like with each other. But then again, like, we are so different from each other, and we are just so much abandoned by each other, and we are nothing but a, like, dispersed and scattered being. How can we gather together? These two philosophers see exactly the possibility of gathering in this dispersion. The fact that we are singular being and dispersed and not sharing much creates the negativity of community, and that's the space we can inhabit within. Is it clear? Like Nongsi is saying, like, that's the supreme indecision. Like, we cannot decide to belong to something and rely on that completely. That's completely indecisive. And kind of this belongingness cannot be accomplished completely, even though there are some forms of this provisional or temporary community. But the core idea of community is not based on commonness, it's rather based on the negation of commonness, or the negative space of gathering. And that's the space where we can gather again. And it's very ironical and somewhat abstract idea, but as I suggest, the relationship between the one and the other as a pre-voluntary thing, I think the negative space of community is quite much unconditionally there.
I think it was somewhat ironic and very abstract, not somewhat abstract and very ironic.